Sometime in the early to mid 90s, I climbed up on the roof of my dad's workshop, 35 millimeter SLR camera in hand, loaded with film, photographed a midsummer night's sunset's rays illuminating the slopes of Mount Timpanogos. I was always photographing the mountains surrounding Utah Valley back then, with an eye toward the lighting and atmospheric effects. All these years later, I will occasionally reference those photographs for a demo piece in a print class. A couple of years ago, I made a line etching using this photo as a reference. I've always really liked this photo. Been intrigued by the house in the backyard facing ours, kind of in disrepair for some reason. The swamp cooler has always intrigued me as a signifier of living out west. And there's all of this rain gutter and stuff falling apart. In contrast to our yard that we worked really hard on, we had a vegetable garden and some fruit trees and really nice lawn. But I was also intrigued by the houses that were up on the hill, particularly this house. I always wondered what family lives up there. Of course, I have no idea. And then, you know, what's behind the hills? And my eyes would always wander and start to daydream about exploring all the way up there when I was a young child. So I made a line etching using this photo as a reference, and it's now time to clean up that plate and transform the composition into an aquatint with full value. An aquatint allows you to use a dot structure on the plate with varying degrees of etching for varying degrees of value. I'm going to walk you through the process. Let's get started. I began by degreasing the plate. You can see the water beading up on the surface. Wet the plate and measure out a tablespoon of whiting or calcium carbonate onto the plate. Spray the plate with an even mix of ammonia and water to create a toothpaste-like substance. Wipe around the plate with a clean shop towel and then rinse off. Notice how the water sheets off now. The plate still carries some corrosion, so I'm mixing salt and vinegar, about 1/2 teaspoon to 1/4 cup, and applying it to the plate to brighten the copper. Rinse, and then quickly dry the plate. Be careful not to touch the surface of the plate, as this will deposit grease from your fingers and negate the whole process that you've just gone through in degreasing the surface of the plate. Place the plate on a piece of cardboard and prepare the rosin box by first knocking the settled rosin off of the removable dowel rods. Then, with one of these dowel rods, scraping the rosin that has settled on the various ledges, of which there are three, back into the chamber. Finally, dust the rosin off the front ledge and door jamb and place it back into the chamber. Resituate enough dowel rods to act as a shelf for your plate. Close the lid and pound the side of the box to loosen rosin from the inside. Turn the crake quickly 30 times. This creates a dust cloud of rosin floating in the upper chamber. Leave the handle horizontal and allow 30 seconds for the larger particles to fall before quickly opening the lid and sliding your plate in face up, resting on the cardboard onto the dowel rods. Quickly close the lid and time for 5 minutes.
Set a timer for 5 minutes.
It's a good idea to wear a dust mask throughout this process. After 5 minutes, quickly remove the plate, being careful not to disturb the loose rosin on its surface. You'll notice a blonde layer of rosin covering 75 to 90% of the plate, especially if you look at it at a low angle. Gently separate the plate from the cardboard and place it on a piece of newsprint resting on the hot plate. Cover the cover plate with the oven box. Did I mention that you should have turned on the hot plate and warmed it to 250 degrees ahead of time? Do that.
Set a timer for 5 minutes.
Once the hot plate has reached 250 degrees, bake your plate for 5 minutes before checking the rosin. While it's not quite as blonde, it still hasn't reached the crystalline amber color, so I'll bake it for 5 more minutes.
Set a timer for 5 minutes.
After 5 more minutes, the rosin looks darker, especially at a low angle. Remove the plate from the heat and let it cool. If nobody else is going to use the hot plate, make sure you turn it off and dial the temperature to zero. Check the surface of the copper plate with a clean fingertip. The rosin will feel particularly plasticky, not crumbly, and there should be no loose dust on your fingertip. I'm checking the surface of the rosin now with a digital microscope just to show you what it looks like. The rosin has melted into irregular half domes, reflecting light like bubbles. You can also see the previously etched lines also holding melted rosin. There should be plenty of space between the melted rosin particles. It melts down to about a 50% coverage. Carefully apply stop out to the areas of the composition that are to remain white. I have previously fixed a tape fishing line to the back of the plate, which has also been sprayed with polycrylic finish to protect it from foul biting. I want a very light value spread for my first few etches on the plate, so I'm timing only 1 minute for the first etch.
Set a timer for 1 minute.
Okay, 1 minute and counting.
After 1 minute, I pull the plate, let it drain just briefly, before putting the plate in a tray full of water. I don't want the ferric chloride particles to create streaks in the Aquatint, so I don't drain it off thoroughly like I would a line etching. Thoroughly rinse the plate in running water to remove all traces of ferric chloride before drying the plate with a hairdryer. Be careful not to heat the plate so much that you burn your hand. Apply stop out now to the areas of the plate that need to be preserved as the lightest gray. Note that the stop-out that I applied previously to protect the areas of white is still there and will remain there throughout the etching process. I don't need to reapply to those areas. Reimmerse the plate in the acid.
Set a timer for 2 minutes.
Okay, 2 minutes and counting.
After the appropriate time has passed, pull the plate, let it drain momentarily, and rinse it as before, and dry it as before. You'll notice that the open areas of the plate are getting progressively more and more discolored, darker and darker. Continue to apply stop out to the areas of the plate that you want to preserve as this second value, the second lightest value on the plate. Noting once again that you don't have to reapply stop out to areas that you've already stopped out.
Set a timer for 2 minutes.
Okay.
I really should be wearing gloves. I've gotten to the point where I'm pretty good about not getting any of this on my hands. If I do get a little bit on my hands, I can rinse it off and nothing happens. But you should wear gloves and eye protection. Notice how the plate keeps getting darker and darker. I'm just going to continue this process of applying stop out, etching it for a particular amount of time, rinsing it, drying it, applying more stop out to preserve the values that I've just etched, and then etching it for another specific amount of time. Another 2 minutes for this etch. More stop out to preserve these mid-tones before putting it back in the acid for another amount of time. Another 2 minutes for a cumulative time of, if you're keeping track, how much? 9 minutes so far. With 5 different etched values in the plate. Another 2 minutes. For a total of 11 minutes of etched time and 6 different values. We're going to put this one in for 3 just to build the contrast a little bit more in the shadows. I'm going to put the final etch time for 5 minutes for the darkest shadows, and we'll have a total of 19 minutes and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 etch values in the plate. I don't need to dry the plate before removing the rosin and stop out with alcohol and a shop towel. May as well remove the fishing line at this point as well. Using putz pomade and 3-in-1 oil, deep clean the plate to remove all residual ferric chloride. Remove the putz with Gugon and degrease the plate with alcohol in preparation to proof the plate. Make sure you always clean the inking slab before proofing. I'm soaking a scrap of coverweight paper larger than the plate. Mix some transparent base into your proofing ink, about 25% by volume, as well as some Miracle Gel Reducer, about 10% by volume. Wipe the plate as per normal practice, first carding the ink on, then off, followed by a light touch wiping with tarlatan and a heavy pressure wiping with newsprint wrapped around a chalkboard eraser. I can already tell that I think I overdid it with the sky. It's maybe a little too dark and the clouds are a little too contrasty, but I can always revisit the plate with scraping and burnishing, which I will do, I suspect, before this video is done. You should definitely be able to see the image on the plate. There should not be ink resting in areas where there should not be ink resting. I'm not particularly worried about perfect registration for proof, just so long as the plate is in the middle of the press bed, face up, of course, and the paper covers the entire surface of the plate. I can always tell who doesn't pay close attention to this detail when I see images printed on the blankets. Speaking of blankets, I often remove the etching felt, which is the middle thick blanket, when printing an Aquatint. So the sizing catcher is on the bottom and the woven blanket is on the top. If you're accustomed to printing with that thick blanket, you definitely need to reset the pressure for this thinner blanket setup. Just as I suspected, the sky is just a little bit too dark for my liking, so I'm going to have to do some scraping and I'll proof it again to see how that looks. I can use the scraper in two ways. First, as kind of a global value reduction, where I'm scraping broad strokes, and then also as a very careful detail thing where I kind of angle the scraper more towards the point, being careful not to scratch the plate with the point, so I can get into those detail areas and really lower or reduce the value. The scraper is going to give some texture to the plate, so if you want to burnish with a burnisher later on to remove some of that texture, you can. But I'm not so worried about the sky, as that texture kind of gives it some atmosphere. and the scraper really has just knocked the value down in the sky and maybe added some nice kind of textural marks for the sky. Of course, I've pre-soaked this paper, and it is, of course, bigger than the plate. And I've got the same pressure. I'm gonna proof this through and see how I like it. These plates are completely flexible. You can add and subtract through physical and or chemical means until you find something that you really like. I'm not so sure I like this, but it seems a little bit better, and I can continue to work the plate. We're gonna look at these three proofs together. The first is the line etching. The second is the Aquatint without any scraping. And then the third is the Aquatint with some scraping. If I like this in theory, then I would go and burnish out the bevel edges and pull an addition.